Hello, I'm Jerry Romine, the Entrepreneur Abroad, and today we're going to look at the top 10 stocks in my personal portfolio, and all of these have been found using the Beast Mode Stock Analysis. A few things to go over before we get started today. Number one, I've only been back investing in stocks after a long layoff for 2 months, and all of these stocks have been purchased in that time frame. Number two, you can see that I practice what I preach when we go through today's portfolio. Number three, many investors that follow my channel may have higher percentage returns than I do, and that's okay. That can be a result of different trading styles, risk tolerance, different stocks that they invest in, or just plain luck. For example, I cover a lot of growth stocks on my channel, but I rarely invest in them. So if you were investing in growth stocks, you might have some phenomenal returns where my fundamental investments would have a lower percentage. Number four, this should be a very educational video because I'll be able to go through my trading style in more detail as we look at the Beast Mode Stock Analysis. Number five, my trading style is very conservative because of my background in trading commodities. In the commodity world, if you don't have your risk management down to a science, you're going to have your butt handed to you on a silver platter. Number six, it's not shown in this video, but I have over seven figures currently in the market and I use a lot of tax-advantaged accounts. Those accounts have all regained back their profits from the crisis. And my investments in the stock market are much higher than average, which I think add a lot of value to this channel and to my Patreon page. Number seven, I'm still concerned about the US economy, and for that reason, I'm still investing smaller amounts than usual. Nobody has a crystal ball, and my first rule is always to protect the capital that I have. Number eight, you cannot score if you are not in the game. Number nine, I'm really looking forward to sharing how I do my risk management once my free tools are available. Hopefully that will be next week, and I think that could be a game changer for some of you. And number 10, the best news is that all of the stocks in my portfolio were previously covered on my stock channel. This means that my gains could easily be your gains. Of course, I'm not a financial advisor, and this video is for entertainment purposes only. So grab a cup of coffee and join me because this is not your normal stock channel. And if you've not already watched my video on how to analyze stocks, be sure to watch it. It'll make things much easier for you, and that link is in the description below. Welcome to the Beast Mode Stock Analysis. Today, we are going over my portfolio and the top 10 in it. We're going to start with the tickers, and we've got SWKS, which is Skyworks Solutions, and they are up 20.05%. We've got Bank of America, ticker BAC. They are up 17.21%. Honeywell International, ticker HON, they are up 14.47%. MasterCard, ticker MA, they are up 14.18%. Apple, ticker AAPL, they are also up 14.18%. We have AVGO, which is Broadcom, and they are up 13.57%. We have Accenture, which is ticker ACN, and they are up 13.52%. And we have EEM, which is an ETF, and they are up 11.75%, and this is a really interesting one because this was a special bonus play for my oil stocks, and this is a mutual fund that is in Saudi Arabia. Then we've got Royal Dutch Shell, which is an oil stock, ticker RDSB. They're up 10.38%, and we have Store Capital Corp, which is STOR, and they are up 10.09%. The first thing I want to draw your attention to is this part of the portfolio is pretty well diversified over a wide range, and we do have a few higher risk stocks. I consider banks to be higher risk at this moment, and I also consider the oil stocks, which would be EEM and RDSB, to also be of higher risk. And then we want to look at the year-to-date stock gain, and we can see we've got a varying group of stocks. Some of them have done well on the year, like Apple, they're up 10.32%, and others were taking advantage of the dip that they had, such as the oil stock, where Shell is still down 41% on the year. All right, in the earnings, income, and growth, this tells us whether or not the companies are making money, and the first thing we want to look at is the PE ratio. And here you can see that I practice what I preach. My top 10 winners all have a relatively low PE ratio. In fact, they average 25. So we've got SWKS with a 27 PE ratio. We have Bank of America at 10.25. And I still consider the banking stocks to be a value opportunity right now. Although we don't know if the economy is going to go up or down. If the economy goes up, definitely a great value opportunity. If the economy goes down, well, that's where the high risk comes in. We've got Honeywell at 17.35. We have MasterCard at 38.05. Apple at 24.42. AVGO at 48.77. ACN at 26.02. This is a fund, so we don't have a PE ratio on this one. We have Royal Dutch Shell and it's coming in at 13.69, and I still think the oil stocks represent a bargain as well. And then we have STOR coming in at 18.89. And the beast mode stock analysis is color-coded, and the light blue is the most important, followed by green, followed by tan. So if we look at the net income margin, this is one of the most important things that I look at as a long-term investor. We can see that the profit margins are very good for all of these different companies, the lowest one being Shell, and it's normal for the oil stocks to operate on a lower margin. So again, here you can see I practice what I preach. Good companies all making money. Value investing is not dead by a long shot. Another important metric is the free cash flow yield, and we want that to be greater than 5%. And the free cash flow yield is the amount of cash a business has after it pays for capital expenditures. And here we can see everybody is coming in with a pretty good free cash flow yield, the lowest being MasterCard at 2.73, with several of the others coming in very high. The levered cash flow is one that I really like, and it measures a company's ability to expand its business and pay returns to shareholders using only the money generated through current operations. So this tells you whether or not that they can pay for everything with the money they're generating right now, and that's a really important metric. Everybody here is coming in really well. And for EAM, which is a fund, we look at them a little bit differently, but I had to include them here just so we can include them in today's list. And if you're a long-term investor, then the return on invested capital is very important because this measures a company's ability to create value for all of its stakeholders. And whenever we look at this, we can see everybody is creating value for the stakeholders, some of them doing a really good job, like MasterCard coming in here at 47.82%. Now, dividends are a bonus when investing in a good company, and my opinion differs than a lot of people. Some people will buy a stock solely for the dividends, and that's okay. Me personally, I would much rather have a higher return, like this number up here on the return on investment, than I would just worry about the dividend. But if we're looking at dividends, the most important thing is we want a dividend yield greater than 4% is good. And we can see that AVGO pays a 4.48% dividend and STOR pays a 6.73% dividend. The financials tells us whether or not a company runs on good margins. And for an operating margin, I like to see that come in above 10%. And the operating margin measures how much profit a company makes on a dollar of sales after paying for variable costs of production, such as wages and raw materials, but before paying interest or tax. It is calculated by dividing a company's operating profit by its net sales, and the S&P 500 average is 10.8%. When we look at the operating margin, we can see that SWKS is at 26.9%, Bank of America 35.8%, Honeywell 21%, MasterCard 56.9%, Apple 24.5%, AVGO 17.8%, ACN 14.7%. This is an ETF, so we don't look at that quite the same way. And then we've got Royal Dutch Shell, they're coming in at 5.1%, but we know that the oil companies operate a little bit differently, so that's not a concern for me here. And then we've got STOR coming in at 58.6%. And in this portfolio review, I've got a lot of really good fundamental companies, so the numbers look really pretty. However, realize that if I had some growth stocks, they could be in here as well, but they would be a different type of investment and a different type of a play, and the numbers would not look the same. So we always have to take into consideration what our investment goals are. And luckily, all of these are pretty much longer-term goals, with the exception of maybe Royal Dutch Shell, where I'll take as much profit as I can from them, but I do think they could be a long-term hold, but if they go south, I'll take profits quickly on that as well. And for the balance sheet, this tells us whether or not the companies are financially stable. The first thing I notice here, Bank of America, their total one-year current excess is in the red, and their cash assets versus cash liabilities ratio is below one. Well, for the other companies, that would be a concern. However, because Bank of America is a banking stock and they make money on debt, we don't have to worry about that for these guys as much. The total assets versus total liabilities is the tattle ratio, because it tattles on the company's overall financial position. And I like to see that coming in at a two or higher, which just means we have twice the assets to the liabilities. So we've got SWKS coming in at 5.9. And another strong one here is STOR coming in at 2.0, as well as ACN coming in at 1.9. The debt-to-equity ratio is something I like to look at, and this compares a company's total liabilities to its shareholder equity and can be used to evaluate how much leverage a company is using. Higher leverage ratios tend to indicate a company or stock with higher risk to shareholders. So on this one, we can tell that Bank of America has a very high debt-to-equity ratio, but again, their business is debt, so that would be expected. We can also see that MasterCard, who is also in the business of debt with credit cards, they also have a higher debt-to-equity ratio, so that wouldn't concern me. Now we move into phase two of beast mode stock analysis, and this is where we get into valuations, price targets, and analyst sentiment, and everything here is subjective. The first thing I notice is the Peter Lynch fair value estimator, and this doesn't work well on all companies, but on certain companies it works really well, so if I get an indication on it, it's something I always like to pay attention to. So what I do notice here is for Royal Dutch Shell, ticker RDSB, we have a near value on the Peter Lynch indicator. So that's something I would pay attention to because generally, if it triggers near value or undervalued, it's a signal that it could be a possible good buy candidate. Next, we have the fair value intrinsic estimator and the beta ratio. And whenever possible, I like to buy below the intrinsic value. And this doesn't always happen, but when it does, it's a good thing. And let's line this up so it's a little bit easier to see here. And here we can see SWKS is currently trading at 128.67, and the estimated intrinsic value is 112.45. I'll let you look at the values as we go across here. And the first one where the estimated intrinsic value is higher than the current stock price is ACN. Then we've got Royal Dutch Shell, which is trading at 33.87. And we have 36.32 for an estimated intrinsic value. And then we have Store trading at 23.33 with an estimated intrinsic value of 25.34. So right off the bat, this is telling us these are possibilities that we might want to look at. Now for me, since I'm already in the stocks on all of these, the good news for me is I bought them and all of them have gone up very nicely, and there's nothing wrong with owning an overvalued stock, but you just want to make sure that you buy it either before it's overvalued or if you're buying it when it's overvalued, recognize that the risk you are taking and then just make sure that you have a really tight risk tolerance so that if it does go south on you that you don't lose as much money. Let's look at the beta ratio, which is risk volatility, and a beta that is greater than one indicates that the security price is theoretically more volatile than the market. For example, if a stock's beta is 1.2, it is assumed to be 20% more volatile than the market. Technology stocks and small caps tend to have higher betas than the market benchmark. So as a long-term investor, we want the lowest beta possible. So anything around one or lower is a good thing. And you can see where these numbers come in. One thing that's really interesting here is EEM is that Saudi Arabia stock that also has some oil stocks in it. And it currently has a beta ratio of 0.78. So that's very appealing to me because it's not really a volatile stock. Analyst recommendations are always fun to look at, and generally speaking, I want to be on the same side as the analyst, but that isn't always the case. So here we've got the number of buy recommendations, hold recommendations, and sell recommendations, and it turns out that the analyst and I really agree on these because there's an awful lot of buy recommendations on these, and there's only, what, three sell recommendations on Apple, yet it still has 20 buy recommendations. For analysts, I take everything they say with a grain of salt, and this is just a quick check item for me, and I would never rely on just an analyst recommendation or the estimated intrinsic value. You want to take in all of this data, look at the big picture, and then draw your own conclusion. The analyst price targets can give us some really good insight, and I like to look at the analyst target mean price, which just means the average, because I want to stay conservative. When I'm buying, I definitely like to be below the analyst target mean price and the estimated intrinsic value. So let's look at SWKS, and we can tell that they're currently trading at 128.67. The intrinsic value is 112.45, and the analyst target mean price is 114.15. So it's trading above those prices. This is an indication that the stock may be overvalued. Now, if I was looking to buy this stock, that would be a red flag for me. However, since I own the stock, when I see this, this could be a good indication for me to watch it closely and possibly take profits if it comes back down. And you can go across and look at the rest of the numbers and see which ones look the most promising to you. When I do look at RDSB, which is Royal Dutch Shell, I can see that they're currently trading at 33.87. The intrinsic value is 36.32, and the analyst target mean price is 40.92. So it's still trading below those values. If you look at Store, you can see the same thing. As a value investor, the book value per share is something that I really like, and the book value is a key measure that investors use to gauge a stock's valuation. The book value of a company is the total value of the company's assets minus the company's outstanding liabilities. When a stock is undervalued, it will have a higher book value per share in relation to its current stock price. Now, if you're a Warren Buffett-style investor, after buying long term, this is a beautiful metric to look at. So whenever we can see that the current stock price is lower than the book value per share, that's a great sign. So if we look at SWKS, we can tell that is not the case. And I use a book value ratio to compute that. And anytime it's above one, the beast mode stock analysis automatically indicates that for us to make our life really easy. So we can see that Bank of America is currently trading below its book value. The current stock price is $26.78 and the book value is $27.84. And if we look over here at EEM, we can see that the current stock price is $39.87 and the book value is $40.41. So anytime I see that I can buy a stock below the book value, that's something that gets me excited. The PEG ratio is another very useful indicator. I normally don't talk about it too much, so let's do it today. This determines the stock's value while also factoring in the company's expected earnings growth and is thought to provide a more complete picture than the more standard PE ratio. A PEG ratio can be negative if a stock's present income figure is negative, for example, negative earnings, or if the future earnings are expected to drop, again, negative growth. So when we look at these numbers here, we can see our best one on a PEG ratio coming in right now is STOR. And then we can see we've got other numbers that are positive, and we can see we also have negative numbers. So if you see a negative PEG ratio, we can go back to the definition and see that it could be that because there are negative earnings or they're possibly forecasting negative growth. So this can be an indication to you for the stock's direction. And again, it's just one more metric and something to consider. And the beast mode has so much data into it that I can only go over a small portion each time, which is why I really encourage people to follow me on Patreon, because you get a copy of this PDF spreadsheet and then you can take your time and go through it, and it just has a wealth of data for you. The Piotrowski score is something that I really like, and it helps us define companies with a healthy liquid balance sheet, profitability, and operating efficiency. So if I was doing a swing trade or a day trade, I could care less about the Piotrowski score, because my mentality is hit it and quit it. I'm going to get in, I'm going to get out, and I'm going to be done with it. It's just about making that quick profit. But if you're a long-term investor and you're holding it, then something like the Piotrowski score becomes much more important. And you can see here that I practice what I preach. The lowest Piotrowski score here is SWKS with a 4. Ideally, we want a number that's going to come in at 5 or higher. Everybody is coming in at 5 or higher except for EEM, which is a 0, but this 0 doesn't mean anything because this is a fund. So again, the Piotrowski score, a great one to look at, especially if you're a long-term investor. And I really love going through this today because you can actually see that I practice what I preach, and the top stocks in my portfolio happen to be fundamental stocks as a result of great fundamental analysis. And our last stop today is the Relative Strength Index, or the RSI, which is a momentum indicator. And as a general rule, a stock is considered to be overbought if it's at 70 or higher, or around 70. So if we look at these, we can tell most of these are coming in with a value of around 70 or higher. So if I was looking to buy, this would be a bit of a red flag for me, because normally I prefer to buy if it's around 30, which indicates that the stock is oversold. But I will also often take positions if it's in a neutral position, which is around 50. So here we can tell that EEM is at 55.01, and we can tell that Shell is also at 59.95. And then if any of them are really high, like SWKS, I would most likely be waiting for a better buy signal. I put in a lot of time, work, and effort into my videos, and if you want to see more, then be sure to like and subscribe to my page to keep this channel growing. And if you'd like a copy of my Beast Mode Analysis spreadsheet, it's available on my Patreon page, and there's a special section just for Patreon members that has a ton of valuable information. Let's talk about lessons you can learn from my trading style. Number one, value investing is not dead. Number two, I like to have a diversified portfolio. Number three, recognize higher risk plays. For example, oil, banks, and airlines, I all consider to be higher risk. And I have nothing wrong with making higher risk investments, but it's just going to be a smaller percentage of my overall portfolio. Number four, wait for a trade to come to you. Once my beast mode stock analysis finds a good stock to buy, I put it on a watch list, and then I wait for a trading alert that I set up to come to me. Once that alert comes, I review the stock, and if I like it, I make the purchase. And that buy signal may take a week, a month, or even longer before it comes to me, and that's completely okay. Number five, most amateurs buy instantly because they do not have a system in place to wait for the trades to come to them. Number six, plan the trade and trade the plan. For every trade you make, you should know how much of a loss you're willing to take, and you should have a plan for when you take profits. Number seven, it's okay to own overvalued stocks, but just make sure that you buy them before they are overvalued, or if you buy them when they are overvalued, make sure you have great risk management management, so you only take a small loss. Number 8, would you believe that most of the time I don't even know what stocks I own? I really don't, and I've built my systems to allow me to process data that determines when I should look to buy stocks. And I'm not emotionally invested in the stocks I own. I'm only interested in whether or not the stocks are performing. Number 9, I'm really happy with the stocks that we went over today and how they're performing. If they continue to perform well, I'll add to those positions. And if they don't perform well, I'm more than happy to liquidate them to protect my profit. And I want to stress that I'm just sharing with you my portfolio and what works for me. I'm not trying to be a know-it-all guru or to tell anybody how to invest. In fact, you want to develop your own style and system that works for you. And you should never rely on some random person on the internet. Always do your own research to draw your own conclusions. I hope that today's been really helpful. And if you need a brokerage account, look into Webull. They've got a great promo going right now where you can get 2 free stocks valued up to $1,400. I personally use Webull and I love their platform.
If you have not already, make sure you sign up for Webull to get a free stock worth up to $1,400. Webull is much more than a free stock trading app, and I have a free tutorial video on Webull that's so good, Webull actually called me after viewing it. Both the promo and Webull tutorial link are in the description below.
Be sure to give me some YouTube love and sound off in the comments below. Thanks for hanging out with me today, and I'll see you soon on a fresh new video.